And so that kind of takes us into our next discussion. I'm going to turn it over to Radu because you sent in this topic and it's totally in your lane. So let's get started on that.
On the employer branding and storytelling of the industry.
Yeah, I think that, you know, that's a good segue to it because I'm talking about storytelling. And the topic that you brought up was employer branding and how to still tell stories to attract talent. Because I don't know about you, but I think one of the hardest things for companies these days is to attract that talent. So how do we do that? What does that look like? What do companies need to do and how do they need to step up? And maybe then we can talk about the future skills that are needed in the industry that you're coming across.
Fundamentally, I'll start with the problem and the challenge that I would say most of the companies face in the space of, call it supply chain, call it manufacturing, call it logistics, shipping. It's not typically seen as a very interesting or
sexy.
I don't know. Yeah, that, I mean, I didn't want to say it because, like, it's been repeated so many times. But it is kind of true. And the reason why it's not seen like that, and the reason why, you know, people want to work for Google and Facebook and God knows, right, tech companies, or they want to work for. Now there's a growing segment in e-commerce, right? I guess. It used to be banks. I think there's still a high degree of interest in fintech. But the reason typically people choose, and we in general, I mean, we can speak about ourselves, right? We like to resonate with the story. What's the company about? What's the vision? What are they trying to change? What are they trying to do? Yeah. Especially younger people, especially since Generation Y, which changed the world to the worst possible way, in which nobody understands what people want anymore. But it's fairly, I mean, it's in many ways, it's pretty much the same as everybody wants as a human being. You want some sense of purpose, right? I mean, I was on a panel, and I'm doing a little bit of a segue here, but I was on a panel, and some of the other speakers were saying that actually Generation X, Generation Z, Generation Y, all of us want the same thing, which is some level of purpose and mission and vision, but just that maybe before people did not have the internet to be as loud and as outspoken, and you didn't have so much options. You had one company that better shut up and just do your job. And now the options are much, much more. So that's why, you know, we get this generational behavior gaps, maybe, but I think at the meaning level is the same. And the reason why these companies, coming back to the point, and employer branding, are struggling maybe to attract talent or to tell their story is that they've not, one, practiced it. It's not really a pattern in the industry. There's been some companies that have done it well, and I'll give some examples because I think they are actually doing it well still. General Electric was one of them. I'm not so sure. I think now they're struggling a little bit, but they were quite strong in their storytelling up to a point, and they are ultimately also broken into different groups. Obviously, each group, depending on the industry, has a different story. A strong one nowadays, I think, is, for example, Unilever, one example in FMCG. Again, you can argue that they have a strong B2C component, so of course they should be able to tell stories because they were also selling you goods.
Right.
But I think there's more than that to Unilever specifically, and why I wanted to mention them, because they push a lot sustainability, they push a lot being able to be at the forefront of circular economy. There's a lot of things that they do really well, and I think they do walk the talk in that vision of being a force for the good. And if I am to speak to a B2B business, which is obviously they're not selling to me and you, they're selling to other businesses, it's Schneider Electric. I would say they're doing a pretty good job at the way they're telling stories to attract talent. If you know the energy management company that sells basically anything in between generators of 5 tons to, I don't know, your switch in the house. But again, they don't sell it to you, Sarah. They sell it to the whoever builds your house and puts in the electric systems, right?
So what are they doing well from a storytelling perspective when you're talking about like Schneider? What can you give us like a specific example of what they're doing well to attract talent?
Very good question. So, and back to my point, I should shoot myself in the foot of making it practical, right? So it's It's that sense of vision, right? So what are we trying to do? We're trying, so firstly, their vision statement, I think, is life is on. And they're trying to be sustainable. They're trying to be innovative. They're trying to, and there's a lot of stories around that they put out there.
Okay.
There's also stories around diversity that they put out. They push that agenda of being a diverse company that accepts all people and tries to again, do good things. That type of storytelling that is basically in line with what do we believe in is very basic, ultimately. What do we believe in? And then tell the people and tell the world what we believe in and how we do it.
Yeah.
But how many other companies are doing it? Not so many. Like, if you, let's talk shipping. Ultimately, the vision is you're enabling global trade. You are helping put bananas from one side of the world in the other side of the world, which doesn't have it, right? It enables, you know, me and you to have goods that we would otherwise not have had 50 years ago. But how many of them are saying it in that way? Hardly any. So that's where I'm coming from, this perspective. And I think the problem becomes because we're also fighting for talent with Google. So supply chain professionals, let's talk data analysts, let's talk data analytics, not to go into artificial intelligence and other buzzwords, but is that type of skill set, for example. Now, that person can get a job in shipping line, in manufacturing, in Google, in Facebook, in a bank, anywhere. So how are you going to attract them to the supply chain realm unless you're able to connect that to some level of vision and change the world for the better, right?
Yeah, and I think that brings up a good point, right? Because not only now are we struggling or are we challenged to get supply chain talent, we're also looking at data scientists, right? Technologists, people that we never really had to reach out to before for our teams, right? These are all the people that we need that are also needed in other industries. So you're right, how does supply chain look to a data scientist versus Google, right? Like, how do we say, well, come and work for us, and they have, you know, an offer on the table from Google? You know, how do you compete with that? And I think you're right. I think what we're missing in supply chain to attract talent is really putting it out there who we are as a company. So forget, I mean, company culture is one thing, and I think that becomes important. But in order to attract them initially, we have to start telling that story. Who are we as a brand? Who are we as a company? What are we doing in the world? Why should people care about what we're doing in the world? You know, what are the things that really matter the most to us that could align with the talent that we're looking to attract? Right.
I have another example that came to my mind, and I think it's very good, and I'll encourage the listeners and our viewers to check it out. There's a company called Soda Stream. I don't know, have you heard about Soda Stream?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They make mineral water out of water.
Yes.
if you want to, you know, kind of downplay what they do, that's what they do.
Yeah.
Now, if you watch all their storytelling, that's definitely not what they say they do. What they say they do is, and ultimately what they actually do is, because that's their vision, is to make the world a better place through one great product, and you get mineral water at the convenience of your own home. And obviously it's also priced better. And at the same time, it's sustainable because it's better for the planet because you don't have to use so many plastic bottles.
Yeah.
And if you watch the videos and the storyline, and they also got the gentleman from Game of Thrones, the one of the main actors, the Mountain, to star in their movies, in their employer branding movies, which is like 2 minutes long, and you can find them on YouTube. And they've even had a sequel of those. I tell you, it was a massive, massive success. And one time I actually posted it on my LinkedIn because I actually wanted to give them credit, and it went viral. That thing went viral because so many people resonated with it, and it's done in a funny way. And on top of the storytelling, which is amazing, and on top of the fact that it's employer branding, and during the movie they actually share their vision and their culture and what they believe in when they attract talent, which also helps them sell the product, right? So it's also a sales campaign. Mm-hmm. But another key element that we haven't spoken about, the CEO himself was driving that. So he was the image, he was pushing for it. He was saying, look, I'm the CEO, but this, so I think that's another element that we haven't spoken about. So storytelling is key. C-level being seen at the front of that and driving that is also key, because you cannot really do one without the other.
Yeah.
And I would say that this particular example is an excellent way of, again, it's B2B, okay, fair enough, but it's manufacturing, not really, I mean, nothing incredibly tech-oriented or anything, right? And I would say how they did it and how they're doing it is brilliant.
Yeah, and I think you bring up a good point too, is that not only when you're selling product to consumers, you have to realize, or other businesses or whoever, you have to realize that through the content that you're putting out there, you're also trying to attract talent at the same time. So you're doing two things with that content, right? You're pushing out your services, you're pushing out your product, but you also want to let them know who you are as a company so that people will want to work for you. They see the vision and they're like, these are really cool products that I can get behind, that I want to work for, and that I want to give my time to. And so, you know, it's kind of a shift in the mindset, right? Because a lot of marketing, you're pushing out your products, you're pushing out your services, but at the same time, you need to do sort of a combined approach.
And to the point with, you know, why wouldn't you join Google? Yeah, but in Google, you're one engineer or software programmer or data analyst in 2000.
Yeah.
In if you sell it right, you can make a difference. You're a bigger fish in small pond versus a small fish in a big pond. So at certain points, you can actually use that into your advantage, but a lot of times, I think mostly in the industry, we haven't really switched the mindset properly, but it can be a big advantage. I mean, people want to come to a place where they can bring a lot of value, where they can see themselves as changing something or adding value to something bigger than themselves, right?
Yeah.
And you can much more likely see the effect of that in an environment like supply chain, then you will see that necessarily in Google, where, okay, yeah, somebody invents Google Maps, but that's one person out of 10,000. I mean, it's not every day that somebody comes up with a totally new idea.
Right. What do you think, Audrey?
I think it's interesting, especially with the level of accessibility to information, and that as a trend, consumers have become so much more educated. So it's interesting to see the what they're curious about, how they're curious about the brand. And then, you know, a lot of, you know, this whole rise of the influencer culture, and really what it comes down to is people want, you know, something recommended to them, or people want someone else to kind of do that educational process, and someone that they know. So, you know, most people like to get, you know, like, what mechanic do you use, Sarah? Are they good? Are they close to me? What, you know, if I'm going to Singapore, what's the best, you know, restaurant to go to? People kind of want that, you know, as close to, if your friend hasn't done it, but someone who seems personable and seems, you know, to relate to you or relate to your experience, right? So you see this big influencer thing. And I think it's the same with work, right? Like, you know, I know here at Orchard, you know, you get a lot of people coming here as referrals because, you know, people like the culture, they like the work experience. Yeah. So, you know, it's, you know, it's always interesting. It's different. We work with dynamic brands. You get to try on product half the day, depending on your job. So it's, you know, it's how it's being received too, through, like, you know,
by the way, good employer right? Branding, Audrey.
Yeah. Yeah. And, but it's like, it's not just from HR. It's not just from, it's, you know, it's kind of your, you know, it's
but
your everyday.
Word of mouth is the strongest.
It's the strongest, yeah. Right? Well, so it's how do you really sink into that and use that?
Well, and you bring up a good point, right? Like your best salespeople are your employees.
Yeah.
So if you want to find out, you know, what people enjoy about working for your company, you need to start there and start asking the question, you know, why do you like working here? What is it that attracted you to this position? Mm-hmm. And build on that, right?
Mm-hmm.
So. Yeah. Radu, when people are looking for talent, I know that you deal in the C-suite side, but what are you saying to them as far as, you know, attracting talent, or how are you finding talent? What has kind of changed for you, and what you're doing at Alcott?
In terms of, just to make sure I understand, in terms of sharing tips with the CEOs in terms of what they could do better to attract talent?
Well, I think that is one point. I think the other point is, what are you telling the talent as far as skills as well to bring forth and put on the table? So, for example, you know, if you're looking for a supply chain professional, you know, is it necessary that they have to have specific supply chain talents? Can skills be learned? Are we looking for a certain type of person? You know, what does that look like from maybe a skills perspective?
Got it.
It's a lot to unpack.
It very much depends on also on the particular assignment that we're called in for.
Okay.
And typically we're called in for difficult assignments. They never call us if it's easy to find. Because also we're not, it's fairly expensive what our service fees are. So from that perspective, and again, I will frame it at more towards the senior level in the organizations, a skill that is probably the most in demand is in, if I can kind of summarize it, one, ability to do change management well, and two, ability to do or to walk the organization through a journey of digital transformation. Okay. Now, these are the fundamentals. So, of course, it depends on what's your angle, right? If you're the CEO, it's one perspective. If you're the chief procurement officer, it's another perspective. It's another angle. Your KPIs might be slightly different, but fundamentally, it boils down to these two. Where one, change management is really how do you deal with people, if you really go to the core simplistic one, and that transformation part and that digital transformation part is really every industry right now is going through that.
Yeah.
So this is very simplistically speaking. So I it's not simple, but this is, you know, in layman terms. Now, is there somebody that knows it all, and especially from a technology perspective where it keeps evolving? And, you know, if you're in procurement, you know, there's a bunch of new procurement platforms out there coming up, machine learning tools, you name it. It's extremely difficult to keep on top of it. Where if you're a chief supply chain officer, again, how do you even keep up with all the information that is happening? I think it's very difficult. So, again, the skills that... If you're a CEO, let's say that if my client is the CEO, they typically look for those two, change management, transformation leaders. And typically, they would need to either have come from the same industry, or sometimes we do get, if the client decides that that's the better way, we do get interesting assignments when they actually want them to not come from the industry because they want them to have a fresh pair of eyes. So we've done a CIO search for... logistics organization, transportation organization, and they took the person from a gaming company because they wanted the person to be quite fresh, not bound to the way things are done in the industry, and come up with a fresh pair of eyes in terms of how to do it.
Right.
Now, of course, that only works if the CEO is really, really determined and will give enough air coverage for that person to actually do what he or she needs to do, because he's gonna shuffle a lot of feathers in that organization, but it can work if that support is given. So that's what we are seeing. So again, I mean, it's horses for courses. I mean, at the end of the day, it doesn't necessarily mean that all the time you should do that, right? I mean, if you have an operations role and you're looking for a CEO, maybe it's not the case to look for from a different industry, because you need to understand the on-the-ground reality.
Right.
And even if you apply artificial intelligence and basically your process is manual, doesn't work, right? You're just wasting your money. So again, horses for courses. There's certain things where it's best to get somebody from the industry, but then you look at the track record. Have you done some major projects of transformation? Have you done some revamp? Have you done some something to that extent? Also, what we do, and we've seen quite frequently, and there's another example where you take from one industry to another industry. A lot is happening right now from FMCG specifically to healthcare, because healthcare is trying to up their games in supply chain. So they take FMCG experts, which are used to fast-paced, low low error margins and try to apply the same principles in healthcare, which historically have not been very, I mean, they have had very high margins and still have, and their supply chain didn't have to be so optimized. Right. So then they're taking that skill set from this industry and applying it to this other industry to make it better. So long answered, but if I'm to fundamentally look at the core, it's about change management, it's about digital transformation, and it's about having some level of proven acumen in having done that in whatever angle you are in. And if I go the mid level, again, that type of skill set and tech and digital type of literacy is crucial. So if you have that type of and you know data analytics and all of that, that's, I mean, I think any company would hire you tomorrow.
Yeah, and I think that's a great point, because if you are looking at your career journey and you're looking at where you want to go and really figuring out what type of skills you need, I think that those are great practical examples, going back to the practical part, of the different sectors and the different skill sets that you might want to focus on now to really increase that journey. And it doesn't mean that you have to take on, you know, a full project at work for change management. Maybe you take on a smaller one just to get the experience and be able to put it on your resume, right? You don't have to go big to be able to prove that. Mm-hmm. I know we're going to get into gender diversity in a little bit, but I want to ask you what your thoughts are and maybe what some advice you can give for women leaders in supply chain or women in supply chain, because a lot of times in my research, I found that women won't go for a job or they won't put in their resume because they don't think they're 100% qualified. Whereas men will go for that job if they're 60 or 70% qualified. So what would you say to maybe the woman in supply chain that kind of think that way when they're looking for a new position? I'm putting you on the spot.
It's not necessarily that I'm on the spot. It's just that I'm not a woman. So let's say my advice, my advice might be not as credible, but I will have some very good sharings, because I've had on the podcast some really strong and well-known women in supply chain, women leaders in supply chain, and I like the type of sharing they've had, because I think that their journey is obviously is much more credible than anything that I can share coming from my male perspective.
Let me ask you from this perspective. So you've got a job opportunity, right? And you're putting it out to your community. And I think that you also seek out people. So, you know, are you having conversations where you're seeking out women and they're not sure if they're completely qualified? And what do you sort of say to that, I guess?
It does happen. So, yeah, I mean, statistically, for sure, I would argue that maybe more women would go for a job if they're 120% qualified, and more men would go for a job if they're 60-70% qualified. Now, I would not say overgeneralize that, but I would say there's a statistic probability that that's going to be more. So it does happen. If I am to be put into that situation, I would typically talk up and make sure I encourage the female candidate to give it a shot and go for it.
Yeah.
Now, typically, it's more of a nudge. It's not like, you know, you're going to push somebody. It's not like women lack self-confidence. It's just that sometimes it's a bit of more of a nudge, yeah. Right? And again, we're talking really big generalizations, so I'm just being mindful. But there's obviously very driven women that have absolutely no problem to go and apply. But I think that nudge is there, possibly. I think for sure we need more role models. I think we need more role models and more vocal role models. And I think it is happening. I think the shift is there. I think we are, and maybe it should have happened long before. But, you know, if you open up LinkedIn now, it's a celebration every time a woman is appointed CEO, appointed. It's all the time in the news. And obviously there's a certain culture shift, right? Because it sets a certain expectation. Now, if you see a picture of only male, you will also see a comment, hey, where's your diversity, right? I mean, why do you only have male? So I think there's also, again, it's linked to mindset, right? So I think the more we're going to see that shift, the more female leaders are out there, the more in general women will be more empowered.
And would you...
it's still work in progress.
Would you tell them just to go for it? just to try? I mean, at the end of the day, what's the worst case scenario? They say no.
Yeah. I mean, something to that. I mean, that's the nudge that I would say. I mean, like, you know, what's the worst that can happen? You go and have a coffee, and if it doesn't work out, it doesn't work out. Now, obviously, if I call them, I mean, I would also use this argument. Of course, if I call you, I mean, I would think that I know a little bit what's happening, and if I trust you, then maybe, you know, just go for it and don't double question yourself. Of course, if that's the main reason why they are hesitating, because there might be other reasons. But
absolutely, yeah, no, that's great advice.